The end of the Second World War in Europe very clearly left one side as the winner and the other side as the loser. Except for many regions, that clear-cut victory, or loss, left a lot of questions, especially regarding the control of territory. The obvious examples of this were in Poland and Germany, both of which saw major changes to their recognized borders. Lesser recognized examples of territorial changes, of course, was the de facto annexation of the Baltic states into the Soviet Union, which would play a major role in the eventual collapse of the USSR. However, one of the often overlooked territorial disputes was between Italy and Yugoslavia over the Adriatic port city of Trieste. The city ended up being a flashpoint in the years immediately following the Second World War, drawing the world's attention and the risk of renewed global conflict. I'm your host, David, and today we are going to take a look at the Free Territory of Trieste. This is the Cold War. Let's start by talking a bit about Trieste itself and how it became an early battleground. The city had been part of the Habsburg Empire for more than five centuries, finding itself as a major commercial port and shipbuilding center, allowing the city to prosper. While the city had long been dominated by ethnic Italians, the 19th century saw a considerable influx of southern Slavs, including Slovenes, Serbs, and Croats, looking to take advantage of the economic opportunities a thriving city could present. Italy, finding itself on the winning side of the First World War after 438 battles of the Isonzo River, absorbed Trieste for itself as the Austro-Hungarian Empire disintegrated. Only a few years later, in Italy, Mussolini's rise to power brought ultra-nationalist policies to the forefront, which were used against the non-Italian populations in Trieste. Following the collapse of Il Duce's fascist regime and the capitulation of Italy in 1943, Trieste found itself occupied by the Germans. This lasted until May 1st, 1945, when troops of the Yugoslavian army entered the city. On May 2nd, however, New Zealand troops arrived at the city as well. The Germans, fearing what kind of treatment they would get from the Yugoslavians, preferred to surrender to the Kiwis. This left Trieste invested by troops from both sides, and both presenting claims to the region. It was clear to most that this was a situation that would not be easily resolved. In order to try and avoid direct confrontation, the chief of staff to the Supreme Allied Commander in the Mediterranean Theater, Sir William Morgan, himself a British Major General, proposed a temporary line in the Trieste region, creating a clear demarcation line between the Allied and Yugoslavian troops. This line, what has become known as the Morgan Line, was agreed to by Tito on the 22nd of May, and by June 12th, Yugoslavian troops had withdrawn to their side of the line. With the line in place, negotiations began. Like any good land dispute, the factors involved were complicated with no straightforward solutions. To start with, Trieste was de jure Italian territory. It was argued, however, that since Italy had been a fascist state and the clear loser in the war, that Italian claims could be ignored in compensation. Further to this was the sizable Slavic ethnic minority that lived in the region. While the majority of people were Italian, the number of southern Slavs that lived there and had suffered persecution during the years of fascism encouraged Yugoslavian desire to protect their countrymen. From a strictly dollars and cents perspective, both sides wanted to control Trieste due to its economic position. As a major port city, it was seen as a key center of trade for southern and central Europe. And of course, underpinning all of this was the nascent struggle between the capitalist West and socialist East, which drove a deep desire to hold and control key strategic points across Europe. At a Council of First Ministers meeting starting in September in London, the Vice Premier of Yugoslavia, Edvard Kardelje, officially presented Yugoslavian claims to Trieste. However, these claims were firmly refuted by the Italians. Interestingly, the Yugoslavian claims were equally rejected by the leader of the Italian communists, Palmiro Togliatti. I guess sometimes ideological conviction doesn't run as deep as we'd like to suppose. The stalemate continued, with neither side willing to concede anything to the other. This was until the French foreign minister, Georges Bidault, suggested to, quote, establish Trieste and its surroundings between Duino and Cittanova as the Free Territory of Trieste, end quote. Since the idea was, quote, liked by no one, it was seen as the best way to break the deadlock and move forward, giving some sort of official status to Trieste. Of course, while the establishment of the Free Territory of Trieste was agreed on in principle, the agreement also lacked any details on the form, structure, or even how the territory was to be governed. Without those little details settled, the Cold War blocs simply continued to argue over control of the territory. The United States was proposing the establishment of an independent Trieste, but under the control of the United Nations. The Soviet Union was seeking a joint protection of the region by both Italy and Yugoslavia, while France advocated for an independent region, but governed by the Allied powers. The United States, for its part, rejected the Soviet proposal out of hand, fearing that the Yugoslavian communists would subvert Italian governance of the area and subsequently allow Trieste to be annexed to Yugoslavia. They felt a strong UN-appointed and backed government would be the best way to prevent this. Keep in mind, this was the early days of the UN before the real effects of deadlock were being felt there. While these negotiations were ongoing, the situation in the jointly occupied territory surrounding Trieste was uneasy, to say the least. There were some altercations between Western and Yugoslav soldiers, resulting in some deaths, but it was a dispute over airspace violations, which saw the greatest level of provocation. Tito complained with increasing bitterness of Allied incursions through Yugoslav airspace by American aircraft. And he was technically correct in his claims, which is the best kind of correct, by the way. But to explain, in the immediate post-war period, the United States was using its own aircrew services to maintain communications to Belgrade as part of the Allied Control Commission. This involved several flights per week from Vienna to Belgrade and was set up due to the lack of infrastructure in Belgrade. By the spring of 1946, however, Yugoslavia was imposing more and more regulations on the filing of flight plans as the infrastructure was improved in order to limit the ability of Allied aircraft to use Yugoslav airspace. Things came to a boiling point in July since US aircraft were in the habit of crossing Yugoslav airspace across the Bled region of Slovenia in order to shorten flying time to Vienna. On August 9th, Yugoslav Air Force Yak-3 fighters forced the landing of a C-47 Skytrain transport, holding the 10 people on board hostage for days. On August 19th, the situation turned deadly as another C-47 was intercepted over Yugoslavian airspace, but this time it was shot down, with the loss of all five of the crew. These deadly incidents could have provided the spark for a renewed fighting in Central Europe, with the potential to create a larger war. However, cooler heads prevailed, and after official protests were lodged and blustering speeches were made, both sides de-escalated. Tensions between East and West certainly remained, however. A further Council of Ministers meeting, which began in November of 1946, saw Trieste come up as a continued topic of discussion. The points of contention surrounded the designation and responsibilities of the proposed head of the Free Territory, the governor, as well as where the allegiance of the police director, how dispute handling was to function, and how trade and customs duties would be applied. After some time, the US proposal for UN protection was accepted, and a commission was sent to Trieste to investigate the situation themselves and get a better understanding of the needs of the city. It took until September 15, 1947, more than 2 years after Yugoslav and Allied troops had arrived in the region, to formally create the Free Territory of Trieste. But even after its creation, challenges remained. No method had yet been decided on how to appoint a governor for the territory. Anybody put forward by the Western powers was rejected by the Soviet Union, and yep, you guessed it, the West did the same for any of the Soviet-backed candidates. So the governorship question was referred back to the UN Security Council. It, in turn, asked the Yugoslavians and the Italians to work together and come up with a suitable candidate by early 1948. The Security Council also used that time to find candidates of their own. And what level of success was achieved? Well, not much. Between October of 1947 and March of 1948, the Soviet Union rejected 12 different candidates for the position, while the Yugoslav-Italian delegation equally failed to find a suitable candidate. And one of the main reasons for the inability to achieve a settlement? Well, a lot of it had to do with Italian elections. The Italian communists were in a very strong position with a real possibility of even winning. Having already seen that a coup could happen in Czechoslovakia, there was genuine fear in the West that Italy would be lost to the socialist bloc. Knowing the emotional pull that an Italian Trieste would have on the electorate, the United States, France, and the UK all publicly backed the return of Trieste to Italy, and along with it, the incumbent government. Italy, of course, endorsed and favored this proposal. The Yugoslavs, as expected, didn't and returned to an old proposal, to swap Trieste for Gorizia, much of which was under Yugoslavian occupation. This was rejected, naturally. Now, for a bit of the larger perspective. By this time, the Tito-Stalin split had already occurred, meaning the Soviet Union no longer had any interest in backing Yugoslavian claims to Trieste. As such, they began a policy of passivity on the issue, a policy which likely allowed for the impasse to eventually be broken. Okay, now you know all this. We should talk about the United Nations Resolution 16, passed in 1947, which is what actually created the Free Territory of Trieste. It was envisioned that Trieste would be governed by democratic principles with a division of power. The governor would be appointed by the United Nations and would act as a head of state, while the running of the territory would be done by a government council appointed from the results of a parliamentary election. Those elections were to be for a unicameral parliament and would be conducted by means of universal suffrage. Now, think back to the beginning of the episode when we talked about the Morgan Line, dividing the territory into two zones of occupation, creatively named Zone A and Zone B. Zone A, under British and American administration, held the city of Trieste itself and contained about 60% of the total population of the Free Territory. Zone B was held and administered by the Yugoslavians. And now, back to the specifics at hand. Soviet ambivalence towards Trieste and then Stalin's timely death allowed some movement to finally happen. In 1953, the United States and Great Britain, with no fear of provoking a confrontation with the Soviet Union, made the decision that the administration of Zone A was to be turned over to the Italians. The Yugoslavians naturally protested, but what eventually came out of that was the 1954 London Memorandum, signed on October 5th, 1954. This, de facto, gave Zone A to Italy, while Zone B, along with some border towns and settlements from Zone A, were allowed to be incorporated into Yugoslav territory. It took, though, until the 1975 Treaty of Osimo for the terms of the London Memorandum to be fully confirmed, thus ending any land claims that either Italy or Yugoslavia had over territory in Istria. Osimo finalized the border between the two countries, lines which remain in place today. The Free Territory of Trieste is one of the so-called forgotten incidents of the Cold War. At one point, it was a potential flashpoint, threatening to turn a Cold War into a much warmer one. Trieste is an example of a situation we've seen a few times already during the Cold War. Lines get drawn on a map in order to create stability and prevent conflict, while negotiations towards a solution are held. But then those lines start to deepen and transform themselves into the de jure solution. I am sure we will see this again in future episodes. We hope you've enjoyed today's topic, and to make sure you don't miss future episodes, please make sure you subscribe to our channel and have occupied the territory surrounding the bell button. We can also be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com, and we're active on Facebook and Instagram at thecoldwartv. If you enjoy our work, please consider supporting us via Patreon at www.patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. This is the Cold War Channel, and don't forget, the trouble with the Cold War is that it doesn't take too long before it becomes heated.